Yes, we can know you are good. Yes, we can know you are good. Oh, so good. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness, you will lead us. And forever we will sing. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We trust you, God. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all. Lord, we're in your hands. We won't move without you. We live for you, the Lord our God.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake.
The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away. May I have your attention, please? Worship will be starting in 1 minute. Please take this opportunity to prepare your hearts for worship and to be seated. And don't forget to put your cell phones on silent.
Lakeside. I would like to welcome all the guests and visitors that are here. Anybody who's not normally with us, thank you for coming today. If you have any questions, ask us. And in the bulletin that you got out front, there is a Connects card. If you put information on that, we will go ahead and send you out just one email and no more until you ask for it. But it lets us know who you are just a little bit. Sorry, Jake. One thing that I would like to do, and I know some people last week noticed the improvement to the sound in our auditorium. Jake Llewellyn has put a lot of effort and time into upgrading, changing, and redoing things. I didn't know how bad the music used to sound, just how muddy it sounded, until they put in the new, and I guarantee you from the other end of the building you could tell how much nicer it was. So thank you, Jay. It took them literally all of 2 days to get it put in. He did do good, didn't he? Just for announcements, most of them are up on the video screen nowadays. I do want to talk about the youth teachers meeting, which is on Sunday, May 21st. That's for anybody who teaches in Sunday school or Wednesday night, anybody who thinks they might want to teach, anybody who's not sure if they want to teach. The meeting is going to be 30 minutes, no more, no less, no dragging over, so it's not going to tie up all of your Sunday. But we desperately need more volunteers, and we don't just need warm bodies. We need warm bodies with a heart for kids. Somebody who wants to come in and wants to make a difference in the lives of all the kids. So come in on the 21st and at least hear what's going on and how you might fit into that. Church Without Walls is on June 11th at the CCC Park. We did that last year. And the first Bible, or not the first, children's camp up at Camp Maranatha, the first camp of the year is June 11th. So we have to get all of the groups spaced out. We have to get the sponsors for them. We have to do a lot of things. So June 11th is when the first camp starts. That will be our drop dead date. However, Saturday, May 20th is the annual Lakeside Garage Sale. For all of the kids, that is an important date. It's a Saturday. We do it from 9 to 3. And we need all of the kids. This is what helps pay for your camp. So it's not just a matter of, gee, Lakeside's doing something else. The church does pay for our kids to go to camp, make sure everybody gets a chance to go. And this is a chance for the kids to come in and participate. We need kids to help put stuff out, to help put stickers on stuff, to load stuff in cars. Anybody that would like to bake something that day and do a bake sale, Dan wants to set up a lemonade stand. He's kind of getting to his younger childhood. And he said, can I do a lemonade stand? Anything you can do to help on that day would be greatly appreciated. And that is May 20th, if you'd pray with me. Heavenly Father, open our hearts, open our minds. Let your word penetrate us, Father. Let your word saturate us today, Father. Let this bring you glory. Let the worship music bring you glory. And let us find that path that you have laid before us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
One other note I'd like to say, the SLT meeting is not going to be tomorrow. It's now been moved to the 15th, so anybody who is wanting to participate, join and listen, that's the day that you need to come. So let's go ahead and stand up and get ready to worship. Father, we come before you. We want to lay everything down that we've brought from this week. Recenter ourselves on you, God. Recenter ourselves on the spirit that you want to share with us, the heart, the connection. God, it's not about us trying to make things right through our works. It's about connecting with you and letting your spirit lead and guide us in our lives and affecting other people. Thank you. Thank you, Father, that you're so free. You're so free. And that you are trying to lead us in that freeness as well. So we're going to get ready to worship you, God. We're going to get ready to have that excitement. You want to share this excitement because, God, you are joyful. It's your spirit of joy that we get to participate with. So thank you, God.
Sun. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Making that sacrifice while we were still sinners. Thank you, God, for loving us beyond our limitations, for seeing more, for seeing what your Spirit can do in our lives. Thank you, Lord. We just want to get out of the way. We want to be rooted in you, Lord. And God, we want to be excited about what you're excited about, God. We want to be excited about your kingdom work. So thank you, Lord. Please continue to show us what that looks like.
I am a soul.
excited about what you're excited about, God. And that starts when we connect with you. So thank you so much for meeting us here. Thank you so much that you are waiting whenever we want to connect with you. Thank you, God, that you're so excited about a relationship with us. Thank you, God, that I can rely on you. I can trust you no matter what I'm going through. I can continue to pour out because, God, I know that you are waiting there to pour back into me when I connect with you.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood. Stand before the throne.
Thank you, God. Yes, yes. Thank you. Father, we're just giving you glory. It's your sacrifice. It's your strength. You are our cornerstone. Thank you so much that we can rely on you no matter what we're going through, no matter the storm, God. You are in control of all of that. So, God, when we forget it, thank you so much for being faithful to remind us we can rely on you, we can turn to you, and we can still be stepping out no matter what we're going through. That's your strength right there when we're stepping out amid the trial, when we're stepping out, when we're going through the pain. Thank you, God, and thank you so much that we are a body of believers. We can work together when one of us is low. We have other people that lift us up. And that's your spirit, God. That's you in work, working through us. Thank you. Father, we love you. And I trust that each of us has something that we need to hear from you today. And God, I know that you're faithful to open our hearts, soften us, and lead us to that truth. So thank you, Lord. We love you and pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You can be seated.
It's on. That's better, right? Good morning, then. Well, it's never a good day unless you mess up a little bit, right? Because it can only get better. I wanted to talk about my last 3 days and how this ties into offering. I'll let you figure that out. I got the opportunity to fish all day for 3 days in a big tournament, 300 and something boats. And it was unexpected because of an emergency and a family member, and I took his place. But we took off Friday morning, and there's 200-some boats behind us. We run about 8 or 9 minutes. All of a sudden, the RPM shoots sky high, and the boat stops. You know, that's never a good sign. Broke the lower unit on the motor. So that's the bad part. The good part, it was straight across the ramp we unloaded at. You know, God took care of that because it could have happened 20 miles up the river we were going up, and the day shot completely. So within an hour, we're on the trailer. They have a mercury repair boat at the tournament. So 2 hours after we broke down, we're unloading the boat again, going to fish. So, you know, for that to happen, cost a lot of money. It's not my boat. It was my friend's boat, thank God. Because mine's in the shop, and it costs twice what his cost. But, it happened in a what place that we could go straight to the trailer, load the boat, go get it fixed, and be back out fishing in 2.5 hours. And then the last part of the story is we finished in the top 10% and won some money. So, you know, thank God that when you have problems, maybe he's looking out for us a little bit because they happen in a situation that can be fixed easily. No one was hurt, just a few dollars, and we were blessed. So with offering, we've got different ways to give. The plates are by the back door. You can text 77077 and then go online to PushPay to lakeside.com/christianchurch.com. All those different ways to pay and give back to God. 2 Corinthians 9, verses 7 and 8. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. And then I wanted to read one other. God wants the spirit of giving more than he wants the amount of giving. It's not what he's looking, how much he's looking for. It's how do we do it? And I'm sure everyone is quite familiar with this story. Luke 21, verse 1. As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. I'll just say pennies. Truly I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she out of her poverty put in all she had to live on. So God is not concerned with what we give him. It's what he lays on our heart to give, and that we give it willfully and happily, not begrudgingly. And that's what I take from that. So for what it's worth, that's what his word says. And we want to move on to communion. If you don't have the elements back by the back doors on the tables, gluten-free and regular here in front, if you want to get those. I looked up the definition of communion. The sharing or exchanging of intimate thoughts and feelings, especially when the exchange is on a mental or spiritual level. It's a spiritual level that we do this, don't we? Remember the sacrifice God gave for us and be grateful for what he did. First Corinthians 11:23-26, very familiar. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Father, thank you for the sacrifice you gave your one son that we might be saved. We're all just sinners, but the second part, you allowed us to be saved by grace. We ask you to bless each heart, each mind, each soul, each spirit as we take communion today. Thank you, Lord. If you peel back the first layer, you'll find the bread. And I'm not very good at this while I'm holding a mic. Go ahead and partake of the bread. And peel back the next layer. Reveals the juice. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning. What we're doing today is we're going to be going over being intentional through the tension. And so we're going to be in the next season, we're going to be going through the book of Romans, and we're going to be talking about whenever God is pursuing people, he's pursuing them for salvation and sanctification. And so we're going to be talking about a lot of different topics that go into it, but it should be broken down as we go through. But the greatest thing is, let's pray. Father God, I thank you so much that we just get to be here and we get to know what you are doing in our life. And so God, I pray that today, have us, have our mind, have our heart, have our soul, have our body. God, I pray that you, the people that come into this room, do not go without being changed. So God, I pray that you just help them to want to turn around. In Jesus' name, amen. So, two things. One is, there was I was talking to God about something, and I was like, God, what is it that makes you smile? Like, what is it that it will, like, it, did I do what I needed to do? Because we're always asking, what is God's will? How do I know what God's will is? And so God was laying something on my heart about rear view mirror. And I was like, okay, if you're going forward and you look back and you see Jesus, whatever you were doing was well worth it. So here's that part of it. It hit me really hard Thursday. Thursday, we got to go over to Branson Convention Center for National Day of Prayer. So around the nation, people have been praying the whole day, and they were praying for the nation and everything else. And what was so cool is that there was 17 schools that went to a prayer breakfast. So I need you to know this. That wouldn't happen a lot of other places. But this was the cool thing. Not only the 17 schools, some of it was Crane, the Blue Eye School. They had students read the Old Testament and the New Testament for the speaker that was going to be speaking. Not only that, that those kids that were there, there were some schools that brought 20 kids. It was like, wow. And so I didn't know all this stuff, but the cool thing, I didn't know the background of it, but I asked questions. I love asking questions. So they actually had the gospel presentation from Billy Graham's grandson. It was just so cool of how that stuff happened. Well, here's how it came about. Is that there was people that wanted to pray, and they had it laid on their heart to invite the kids. And so businesses paid for the students to come. I'm telling you, they got Jesus. And so whenever we were driving away, like there was these, it was at least 100 to 150 kids coming out of this convention center. And it was cool because they were just not running amok, but they were just like, it looked like an ant farm came out. And so it was great because when we were driving back, I said, God, did you get glory? And he goes, look in the rearview mirror. And all I saw was these kids that were invited by their administration. Like you had to actually say yes by the administration. The administration was Jesus to those kids, because the truth is they didn't have to go. There were some schools that didn't go. But thank God for the ones that did. Yeah, So here's that thing. In the Ozarks, there's things God is doing that he's not that they don't allow him to do in other places. The great thing is, that's just the skim of it. And so we're going to be going through Romans, and we're going to be talking about how to go through the tension. Because how many of you know the tension that's going on in this world? Okay, there's tension that's going from without, and there's some tension that's from within. And Paul is talking to Rome, which had a lot of tension. The great thing was God was trying to get every last person's attention. And so we're going to be going through of how to look at the book of Romans. But what I thought was it'd be good for us to look through the rear view mirror at what Paul did. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be just looking in the book of Acts at the very end, but I need you to hear this. God had a plan, and Paul didn't know all the plan. Have you ever had a plan, and you knew God wanted you to be somewhere, but then you go, oh, wait a minute, that's not what I expected, and then God goes, if I would have told you, you probably wouldn't have been there. But God had a major plan for Paul. God's plan was to break Paul's heart for Rome, for the Gentiles, for the Jews. And he was a Pharisee, but he was a past Pharisee, but he was also a Gentile because he was of where he was born. And so he had a mixture, but that tension actually was what God wanted to use. And so instead of the tension stopping you, walk through it because God can use it. So, sum up. So, for the next season, we are going to be going through the book of Romans. And so if there's anything that you could learn today, this is what I want you to learn. When you belong to God, there is always an inner tension and an outer tension that you must work through faith to do the right thing God's way. There's always going to be tension. Go, well, when there's no tension, I'll do something. Well, then you'll do nothing. Because there's always tension. What are you going to do? How much attention will you give God no matter the tension that's going on in this world? Will God be able to see Jesus in your rearview mirror? Will you be able to see what you've left is just Christ? And that's what Paul focused on. So the book of Romans, if I could sum it up, is being intentional straight through the tension. The best way, I think, to look at the book of Romans is to look into the rearview mirror. What God did with Paul past the letter. So he sent the letter, and then Paul was like, I want to come here. I want to be able to do something in Rome. But God was holding him back. Why? Because God knew Paul was going to end up in jail in Rome, and Paul is a very determined person. Jesus was going to get glory even if he was in jail. So Paul didn't know that. God did. So the rear view mirror thing popped up in my head whenever we were talking in our small group. Guys, small groups are very valuable because you get to have not only God's word for the context and everything, but you get to be allowing God, let the Holy Spirit share through other people, and you get to hear things in a different way than it would just be right here. There's things that happen in community. There's things you hear. And so whenever we were talking, someone goes, well, how do you know God's smiling or God's will was done? It was look in the rearview mirror. Like when you go past it, because a lot of times we don't know what God's doing, but we know what God's doing after he's done it, right? God, you just did that. And then also being able to go, is Jesus in that spot? Because wherever Jesus is, that's where God's will is. Why? Because he's in the middle of God's will, no matter what. So, what the Holy Spirit said in that letter was lived out through Paul. The letter of Romans was written from Corinth just prior to Paul's trip to Jerusalem to deliver alms to those that was needing it, in the poor that was needing it there. He had intended to go to Rome and then to Spain, but his plans were interrupted or directed by God. And he wasn't directed by God to get arrested. He was going to get arrested no matter what. Why? Because he was not ashamed of the gospel. He was focused on Christ, and he was going to do whatever God wanted him to do. And so he was arrested in Jerusalem. To keep a watch on him, they were ending up sending him to, they were either going to try him there, but since he's a Roman citizen, he appealed to Caesar because he wasn't going to survive any other way. And so here's this, he ends up going to Rome, and he has to be under Roman watch, but he ends up getting his own rented room, and he invites people to come and hear about Jesus of his own expense. Why? Because he wanted access to anybody and everybody so that anybody and everybody could have access to Jesus. So he was going to do everything in his power to make sure that he did what Jesus wanted him to do, even if his circumstances, his tension was overwhelming at times. And so if I can just help you to realize, the book of Romans is one of those things of, what are you going to do with Jesus? And what are you going to do for Jesus? And what are you going to let Jesus do through you? That's it. I want to see Jesus in my rearview mirror. I want to see Jesus, God doing the things that he's doing, going, God, I don't know what you're doing, but you're doing something. And then God goes, good and faithful servant, after.
So if we're going into this, we're going to go into Acts 28, and this is when it's talking about when Paul was actually in Rome. He finally arrived, and this is what happened. So first thing that happened that shows in the rearview mirror of how impactful the book of Romans was Paul dealt with the tension by being intentional. Acts 28, 17, 22, and 24 says this. After 3 days, he called together the local leaders of the Jews, and when they had gathered, he said to them, "Brothers, though I had done nothing against our people or customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. But we desire to hear from you what..." Oh, so they end up answering, "But we desire to hear from you what your views are." They were interested. "For with regard to this sect..." They called Christians a sect. You're a Christ follower. "There's something new about you. We know that everywhere it is spoken against, when they had appointed a day for him, they came to him at his lodging in great numbers. From morning till evening, he expounded to them, testifying to the kingdom of God." Isn't that cool? All these Jewish leaders and everybody else, they were like, "We'll be happy to listen to you." And what he did was he expounded, testifying from the kingdom of God and trying to convince them about Jesus, both from the law of Moses and from the prophets. Why? Because the Lord Jesus was the Lord of all in the Old Testament. He's the Lord of all in the New Testament too. And all he was doing is just going, here, let me connect the dots for you. And some of them were convinced by what he said, but others disbelieved. So, when we're thinking about it, after 3 days, he pursued all the leaders. Why? Because Paul was going to be intentional. I'm going to tell you this. All of you are leaders. All of you. You were meant to be disciples of other people. You were meant to lead other people. And so you were meant to be intentional. If you're not being intentional, you're not being a Christian. You're not being a disciple. Because Christ was intentional all the time. Why? Because God's will needed to be done. His kingdom needed to be expressed. Jesus needed to be held strong. And so, it says, he found a place and settled there and got to work. Christ's work. His heart was after what Christ would be after. He wanted the Jews first to hear the message. And whether or not they were going to hear it is their fault or their choice. So, to be intentional, what is pursued will always show the heart's motives. Can I be honest with you? You can have people tell you everything and it can sound really flowery and good. But the people that you need to notice is those that actually carry out what they say they're going to carry out. You need to pay attention to those that actually trust God enough to get uncomfortable. And so Paul didn't just write from the Holy Spirit's guidance the book of Romans. His heart broke for the Romans. There was nothing going to stop him from every day, morning till night. There was nothing more important. Why? Because the most influential people are the most intentional people. You want to influence this world? Do stuff over and over for God. And not just for God, because of God. You can do a lot of things for God, because of God. Because God gave you mercy, give mercy. Because God loved you, love others. Because God. And that's what he was going over and over in these people that had the Old Testament memorized. And they still couldn't see Jesus. Why? Because what they were trying to find out is what pleased them, not pleased him. And so, be intentional, because a lot of times people aren't fighting with you whenever you're sharing the good news with them. They're fighting themselves because they want to have their way. And I'll be honest with you, the best way is God's way. I'd rather feel uncomfortable and be in God's will than to be comfortable and miss it. So from morning to night, he expounded on what he knew they knew, because he was a Pharisee. So he knew the Old Testament very well. He knew what the, and he was connecting the dots. Da, 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 connect the dots. You know, just keep on doing whatever you need to do so that they can say that dot goes to that dot that goes to that dot. And that's how God made it. So he was filling in the blanks for them, testifying to the kingdom of God, trying to convince them about Jesus from the Old Testament and from the prophets. So here's what Matthew 6:33 says. So this is the most important thing. Jesus goes, the Gentiles focus on what they're going to eat, what they're going to drink, what they're going to wear. But you want to know what the greatest thing to focus on? Be intentional about your attention. Ready? It says this, but first and most importantly, seek, aim at, strive after his kingdom. Is that important? And his righteousness. So his way of doing and being right. Is God right? Prove it through your actions. Prove it through your trust. I trust Jesus to be right because he's righteous. I believe that God is right because he's righteous. I'm going to let his righteousness lead me, not my own righteousness lead myself. And so it says, his way of doing and his way of being right, the attitude and character of God. God's not just right, he is right. He doesn't try to prove himself right, he is right. Stop fighting him. Stop. If you try to prove yourself right, you're going to prove yourself wrong. Just let him be right. Francis Chan is someone I really respect because I see what he does in the rearview mirror. He's chasing people, lost people. He's the one that wrote The Crazy Love and just a whole bunch of stuff. But I pay attention to people's lives, not just what they say. And he said this. He was walking through Israel. He's starting a new series on the book of Mark. And he asked, and he goes, and you wonder, wow, what kind of message have we been preaching here in America? Has it been the true gospel? Or is it just what we're comfortable with? And is my mind warped just because of the world I live in, and how can I escape from it? So here's that thing. Ready? Paul wrote to people that needed Jesus even before he knew what God was going to do with them. Why? Because the intention of his heart was people need the truth. If that is your motivation, don't worry about anything else. Just let his will be done in you. Focus on what would make God smile and just go, this is worth it. Paul sacrificed a lot. But that's what Ananias said at the very beginning. You remember whenever he first, he was pursued by Ananias, and Ananias is like, God, I heard of this guy. He's the one that's beating up all the Christians. You want me to go to Saul? And he goes, just know this. I have made him a specific instrument to reach the Jews, the Gentiles, and I'm going to show him how much he's going to have to suffer for my name. Okay, wait. Jesus, I love following you, but suffering is not the thing I heard whenever I heard fluffy Jesus. Oh, no, he's not fluffy. Jesus is a warrior. Jesus is a fighter. Jesus is a lover, but he also is just. And so whenever Paul was going to the Romans and writing to the Romans, it was out of a broken heart for the Romans. So you have to know this. Let his righteousness and his kingdom be the most important thing. All the other things will fall into place. Don't worry about how it's all going to come together. His kingdom, his righteousness. His kingdom, his righteousness. His kingdom, his righteousness. You want to know the real thing is? Let his will be done on the outside of you and the inside of you. Focus on that. And then you will impact all the other people exactly how you need to. So here's this. We need to ask about his kingdom, his will, and pursue his righteousness. He is right inside and out. The greatest thing that you could ever pray, ready, is this way. God, I know you're right. Can you do it your way? Can you have it handle your way? Can you show me your way so I can pray your way? Can I walk your way? Can I fight for your way? Can I suffer for your way? Can I trust your way? I really want your way to be my way. And I want to be right, not because I'm trying to prove myself right. I'm just following the right way. That's how I want to be right. I don't want to be the one that has to be right, because that's a burden that we were never meant to be. But we can follow the right way, and we can let it impact us and everybody else around, because his kingdom and his righteousness is what this world needs. Paul wanted them to come to a decision, because every time that you face the right God, you have a decision. Is he right or is he wrong? And the Jews, some of them said, he's right. And some of them disbelieved and said, no, I don't believe it. So here's this, ready? Just because you think you're right, you're never going to prove God wrong. Because God's not going to be proven wrong. He's going to be proven right. He's lasted for eternity. And all the people that has ever done wrong to him, they've never been able to prove him wrong. The Bible has stayed here longer than man. So let's try to prove him right. And then we'll actually have a great life because he's right. So it is all boiled down to the, and some were convinced by what he said, but what Paul said, but others were disbelieved. It is all boiled down to a decision. Will I be the Lord of my life or will Jesus? So here's that question for you before we go to the next one. Who's the Lord of your life? Paul already made a decision. Jesus is the Lord of his life, and he was willing to give everything for that. If you're the Lord of your life, you will be broken down one day. If Jesus is the Lord of your life, you will break down many barriers that God has always hoped someone willing to prove him right. Here's the second thing. Paul dealt with tension with God's word and promises. Acts 28, 25 through 31. And disagreeing among themselves, they departed after Paul said something that stirred them up really bad. Paul had made one statement. The Holy Spirit was right when he was saying about you, your fathers, through Isaiah the prophet. So what did he do? He went to Scripture and God's promise. Now, they didn't want to hear what God had to say. You will indeed hear, but never understand. You will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's hearts has grown dull, and with their ears, they can barely hear. They'll hear some, but they can barely hear. And their eyes, they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn to me, be converted. So this is it. Ready? They had a decision to just go, my way is not the best way. God's way is the best way. I'll turn to that. But they didn't want that. And God gives a promise. If they turn from their ways, I will heal them. I don't know why I keep on getting bombarded all the ways. Are you going God's way or are you going your way? Because sin has consequences. Stop it. God's right ways will always be right ways. Your ways will always be in any direction, and it will lead you in destruction. Therefore, let it be known, and this must have been a slap in their face. It must be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles, and they will listen. Oh, my word. The most godly people in the room was not the ones that was listening. It was the ones that were so lost and so hurt and so bombarded. So Paul shared that they should see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn and convert, and he will heal them. So here's this that I need you to hear. Ready? If we're going to be intentional through the tension, there are some topics that are difficult to express because it gets personal. You know that people love to hear it until it gets personal, and they're like, okay. But God needed Paul to get personal. Guys, we were meant to do life with each other. We were meant to be personal with each other. And this life that I'm doing my thing and you're doing your thing is not a godly thing. It's a world thing. It's worldly wisdom. We have to do stuff together. And so people putting their lives into our lives, actually it gets personal, but that's what God wants. It must have been hard for God's chosen people to hear that they were not entirely right. My righteousness is great. And then God goes, that wasn't my righteousness. That's yours. And it's like rags. They stink. I need you to let me be right. And the Gentiles are letting me be right. Can you get with it? Can you stop being prideful? Can you stop trying to do your own thing and do my thing? It must have been refreshing to the Gentiles that Paul goes, the Gentiles are going to get the gospel and they will listen. Have you ever heard someone say something about you and you thought you were trash and they said something great about you and you go, I don't know if I even understand, but I'm going to trust that. What if that right there was that part where when Paul sent the Romans the letter, because it was a letter, and it was to encourage them, it was to them to understand what salvation is and how the Jews and the Gentiles all put together, and then also how do you, what does sanctification look like? What is that whenever you're set apart for God's will? Like, what does that look like being an instrument of God? And they heard, they're going to listen. I'm going to tell you, there's been kids that I've worked with and adults I've worked with, and because everybody has been saying that they're not going to be good for anything, guess what they're going to do? Not be good for anything. They're just going to go with it. But have you ever saw someone actually take the time to encourage someone else and go, you're worth it. You're listening. Yes, you're making mistakes at times, but you are doing more for the kingdom of God than people that normally is for the kingdom of God. Stop listening. You're listening to God. What do you think that would do for you? these people, these no, because Jews hated Gentiles. Jews hated Gentiles. But God didn't. So, it must have been refreshing that they got to hear. Sometimes you're listening and you don't think anybody's paying attention. God is. You're doing the right things and no one else is noticing. God is. You're doing things for the right reasons. His righteousness is over you. Because the truth is, you're trusting in his strength, not your own. And so here's this. So the book of Romans, if I could just sum it up from how Al says 50,000 feet up, is the book of Romans shows God's way is needed. God's way of handling life is through faith. God's way works out in the end, and God's way deserves our full participation. So how many of you heard God's way multiple times? The major thing about Romans is God's way. Not your way. Not how you think the way it should be, but God's way. And us getting to know God's way. So Paul goes through the Old Testament and the New Testament. He goes through the heroes of faith and everybody else. And he helps to break down all these different things of going, oh, wait, that's your way. Here's God's way. This is your way. This is God's way. And so he breaks it down. So this is the greatest thing you can ever do. Ready? Let God's way be your way. Stop trying to be right. Let him be right. And let his ways be true in your life. And so all the tension that happened, I will tell you, I have a lot of respect for those administration people over at the schools that allowed their kids to go. Because I've heard of, there's a lot of times people will get opportunities, schools get opportunities, and they won't take it because it blurs the line. And I'll tell you this, is what I respect. There was this baseball player, teacher, this coach, and we were in a school, and this coach had a problem. He was bringing the kids to FCA, Fellowship of Christian Athletes, and he had a kid that was an atheist. But his dad threw a stink and whatever, and he goes, hey, just know this. I'm not just teaching them baseball. I'm teaching them how to be men. And the greatest man I know is Jesus, okay? So later on, I think it's the guy, but I'm pretty sure that the kid that was that kid ended up coming back because there was something that he encountered, and God got his attention, and he came even if his dad didn't want him to come. So I need you to know something. When people are willing to let God get the most important things, his way gets to be the best way, you will do things that you go, that doesn't make sense, but we'll go forward, and then God goes, this is how it makes sense. Connect the dots, la, la, la. You know why? Because he's right. And every person that tries to prove him wrong one day will have to admit in front of him they were wrong. They might sound right, they're wrong. Let God's will happen in your life, because that's what Paul did. Paul's heart broke over the lost and those that were supposed to be found that were lost. Last thing, Acts 28, 30 through 31 says this. He lived there. This is Paul. He lived there 2 whole years at his own expense. He stayed there at his own expense. Why? Because God broke his heart over Rome. And he wasn't going to leave Rome. The problem is, or he wasn't going to leave that place. He was going to stay in that place because he saw God doing stuff. And welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. He was purposeful. If there's something you could hear, this is what I need you to hear. being intentional through the tension. If God's word said it, or if God promised it, proclaim it boldly. If God's word says it, if God promised it, proclaim it boldly. Read the book of Romans yourself this week. It's very easy. Just read it. Read it yourself. Ask God questions about it. And I want you to get an answer from God first. But the truth is, I would love to hear some of your questions. Like, send it through the email. I have an email. If you don't know it, look on the bulletin. It's there. But I would love to hear what God is laying on your heart of going, okay, this is what the book of Romans is laying on my heart. Because the truth is, I really believe that testimonies about what God is doing is a rear view mirror look and going, God, you were faithful. I am faithful, David. No, I just want to prove you faithful. I want everybody else to trust you fully. And this is it. It's going to start with us just reading God's word for ourselves and letting him do exactly what he was meant to do. Change our lives. You cannot stay the same in God's presence. You can't. We all have growing to do. And if you say that you don't, I think you have a pride problem. So, here's that thing again, what I wanted you to hear at the very beginning. When you belong to God, there is always an inner tension and an outer tension that you must work through faith to do the right thing, God's way. So here's that thing. We're going to be going through the book of Romans, and what I want, those that need to go up, please go up. What I want is this. I want you to encounter God. I want you to encounter Christ. Yes, I can encounter, but I want you to. The great thing is, you guys encourage me, and I encourage you. That's what discipleship is, and we need discipleship. We need each other, and we need to go out and share. And that's when God breaks our heart over Shell Knob, we'll see more people go out and share the good news, not because they want to. It's because they have to, and then they'll want to. Does that make sense? If anybody, everybody stand up. If anybody has something that God's laying on their heart to make a decision on or prayer, please come up.
Throne to build it here inside, and there
Free. Thank you for this grace and this mercy.
So you guys have a decision. You have a decision to accept Jesus and share Jesus. Those are the only two decisions that really matter in the whole scheme of life. Make those decisions today. Have a blessed day. God bless.